Hello everyone and welcome to DevOps Stage Conference. My name is Vlad Gram and today I will discuss with you so-called toxic enterprise projects. How and why, what are the reasons and what is the story behind this toxicity and how projects are becoming toxic? And I will analyze the root cause of this toxicity from the methodology point of view. And then we will discuss some system level decisions and some steps that DevOps team and the delivery team as a whole can take to detoxify and to fix those issues on the project. So I already introduced myself. My name is Vlad Gram. I'm working as a head of DevOps unit in Siklum Digital. And I've been in the DevOps world for more than 5 years and in IT world like for more than 15 years. As a DevOps, I spent a lot of time on different outsourcing programs and projects. So I've been there as an engineer, as a team lead, and as a program lead for the DevOps team. You can find my contact and information on the slide. So let's begin on our presentation. First of all, let's discuss on why enterprise projects and why we are focusing on them. Enterprise projects are good. I personally love them so much because they are providing so many experience. And this experience is not only about DevOps, it's a cross-domain experience. It's an experience on how business works from inside. It's an experience on how people communicate to each other and how this communication can be broken or effective in different ways. It's an experience of working in international communities and teams in a different region. And from outsourcing company point of view, enterprise projects are super good because they generate most of the revenue and most of the work for the outsourcing company. But still, engineers tend to avoid enterprise projects and they call them toxic and they call processes on such enterprise level projects as broken or inefficient or even abandoned. So what are the problems on the enterprise? What are the issues? You can name them all, but I will start with some that I personally encountered on different projects. Of course, there was no single project possessing all of those issues, but in some cases, in some projects, there were like fragments and some kind of points where things were super broken and went wrong. So what are those issues? Like for example, every task is critical because there is no single person who can set priorities. Micromanagement to expedite those tasks because they are critical for the management. Inconsistent processes for some new things or for some old legacy things that are still there. And legacy code itself, legacy integrations, legacy infrastructure, legacy processes in terms of creation of resources or requesting resources. Long email threads where people just trying to understand what is going on. Knowledge silos where you have to be in context because if you didn't create this resource, you cannot know how it works and what are the workarounds implemented in this solution. Now, there can be even lost code or unknown code or person who have written this code is not in the company anymore and no one knows how it works. Sometimes you can even remember, and there was an issue from my experience where some person were using its own credentials for some scripts. And when he left the company, all scripts were failing because he put his own keys and his credentials were revoked. So sometimes it may be like approvals for every step that you are doing. You want to change something, you need approval. You need to add some resource, you need approval from, I don't know, budget committee. Sometimes it's extensive reporting where you have to write report over report over report, and some of those reports are in Excel, some of those reports are in Confluence, some of those reports are in email form, but still you will have to report extensively and sometimes waste your time on these reports, and no one reads them. Most of enterprise level projects have distractions, especially for the DevOps team. We will discuss it later. Everything may be urgent, everything may be critical. Sometimes DevOps team or team members are participating in some frustrating meetings. They don't understand why they are here as well. Sometimes it can be outdated documentation, or sometimes some work they do is unfinished and left unfinished because no one wants to implement it in production and break something. So you can name lots of symptoms, lots of toxic signs that you can find on the project. But when I'm looking into the slide, it hurts me a lot because all of this is based on real experience. But there is a way to fix that. Why I'm talking about DevOps when I'm discussing issues with the management? Well, there are two reasons. Reason number one, because DevOps engineers are in the middle of the storm. DevOps team is suffering the most of those toxicity and those issues because DevOps team is needed everywhere. DevOps team is cross-functional and DevOps engineers are communicating with different sides of the business. DevOps pipeline, DevOps products, infrastructure, it affects all products and all teams, and it affects more than just DevOps area of responsibility. You can see those numbers on the slide, but I have no data to prove that. It's my gut feeling that DevOps engineer is attending much more meetings than any other software engineer. And DevOps engineer is being distracted much more often than any other software engineer working in QA or development. Also, DevOps area of responsibility is pretty fuzzy. Sometimes you even don't know if you're responsible for that or not, or who is responsible for this part of the infrastructure. DevOps will be the first point of contact in case of any issue, and DevOps, again, is being distracted by lots of ad hoc tasks that are critical or urgent. But spoilers ahead, DevOps is a team who can contribute the most into fixing those issues. So what is the simple truth behind this toxicity and behind those issues on enterprise projects? The simple truth is that in a large growing and changing environment, there are always cross-dependent components which are affected by different people. And every symptom of this cross-dependency is there for absolute logical reason, and every symptom of this toxicity were treated as a good solution here and now in some past. Business stakeholders, they just don't want to make their project toxic. They want to fix the problem they see right now. They want to get feeling of control. They want to understand what is going on. And the problem here is not people, it's not methodology, it's not the technology you are using. The problem here is actually based on a system level. It's some kind of system level contradictions that cannot be fixed or cannot be seen from the inside. From the inside of the project, it feels just like you're getting more and more issues and you just do not understand why this amount of problems, this amount of incoming requests and issues and amount of some alerts, angry people is increasing over time. It feels like you're just drowning into the swamp. So let's take a look on the most irritating symptoms and on the story, how these symptoms are getting here and when management is makes decision to put those symptoms into the project. First irritating system that I took, it's about responsibility mix. So why there is a mixed responsibility on the project? First of all, because the project is big and sometimes you even cannot predict and cannot know that you are sharing something with other team or with other competency. So at the beginning, you can split the responsibility over the resources. But even in technology world, even in DevOps part, in infrastructure, sometimes you will have to gather few people to discuss some integration issue that affects both parties, and both parties can say that on our side, everything is working fine. So you will get a shared responsibility just by design, just because there is a shared resource or some resources are requiring involvement from different people. On some level, you may not know that you share something with other teams. And let me give you some examples. So for example, IAM services, they are shared between, I don't know, cybersecurity team, for example, and IT services team and DevOps team, because DevOps team require access to IAM services to provision some kind of service accounts. Certificates and DNS zones. In my experience, there was a story when certificates were owned by marketing team as well as DNS zones, because marketing tend to be the responsible team for the web development and for the website of the company. Integration points, they can be even owned by other company or other organization that is in partnership with you or your customer. Infrastructure can be shared with everyone else. And last but not least, budget can be also shared. So the responsibility mix is here for the reason, because you cannot predict the responsibility. The only thing that you can predict is ownership. What about priorities? Sometimes all tasks are critical. Sometimes everything is urgent. You are blocking all the teams simultaneously. Why? Because you know, DevOps competency meant to be cross team, and you have to work with multiple teams that are developing multiple products. And the production environment hosts those multiple products. And when some shared components fails, all the teams want to be unblocked. When the CI/CD component is not bringing enough speed, or there is some issue in the CI/CD itself, or there is issue in some fuzzy responsibility area between you and developers, the whole team may be blocked. And you know, team leads of those teams, they are responsible for their own chunk of work. They come to you, they ask you what happens, and they are urging you to make sure you're unblocking their team. And sometimes they may even not know that the other team experiences the same issue. So you are getting distractions, you are getting critical tasks, and there is no person who can say which task is in priority, because both teams are blocked, both teams are important, and both teams are responsible for an important part of business. So you just can't prioritize it because you are not a product owner for both teams and they have their own product owners. And also you feel stretched. So DevOps team almost always feel stretched and it consumes energy. And about extensive reporting. So unclear priorities and issues with the shared area of responsibility leads to the feeling of loss control. And managers are responding to this feeling with requests for additional reporting. They just want to know what is going on. And some reporting processes live longer than managers that started those processes. And from the beginning, it creates illusion of control, but it frustrates the team, and it also frustrates creates additional chaos on the long run. Common symptoms of extensive reporting, it's redundant meetings. It's when on a daily stand-up, you just have to report what you did yesterday instead of planning and discussing impediments. You have to create ticket on ticket on ticket. Sometimes you need to over-monitor and you will have like polluted notification channel. In my experience, there was a notification channel for creating any resource in AWS because someone wanted to control spendings on a cloud. And this channel was abandoned. Everyone muted it because it was overpolluted with notifications because at least 5 or 6 teams were working with the AWS and constantly creating and decommissioning resources. One of the most common symptoms of this issue is when you have to do reports not only in ticketing systems or email, but also in Excel or Confluence or other systems, and sometimes in all of them simultaneously. So let's try and do the root cause analysis. And here I will cheat a little because I will not analyze the root cause of how these symptoms appeared and why. I will analyze our work as a DevOps team and as a software delivery team from methodology point of view and check our work against different methodologies. So let's take a look at the Scrum first. Why I'm saying that in DevOps world and in software delivery, most software delivery companies, the Scrum is broken. First of all, DevOps team in every enterprise project, DevOps team will have some degree of centralization. Some parts of infrastructure will be shared between different teams. Some parts of networking, some parts of limits, for example, there are some limitations in cloud that can be also shared between different teams. Sometimes budget can be shared between teams. And from the DevOps perspective, it requires some level of centralization and some level of shared resources and cross dependency between teams. This means that DevOps expertise cannot work as a Scrum in many ways. Because first of all, it's not an independent thing. It's not a product itself. We are helping to deliver other products from the Scrum point of view. We cannot be fully self-organized because we have lots of incoming work and we have to work with different development teams and developers. And this means that you cannot just put DevOps engineers, give them a sprint gives them a backlog and protects the sprint from changing the scope. It's just impossible because there are lots of ad hoc tasks, there are lots of incoming tasks that should be fixed instantly or fast. Okay, but we can work as a Kanban, we can work as a service team, and we can work with incoming ad hoc tasks just using the Kanban board and go one by one. Yeah, it's cool. It's a good idea. Ad hoc tasks are unavoidable in DevOps world, and Kanban is a natural and good idea to work with. But you know, in most cases, in most teams, Kanban means just that you have a board in Jira with tasks. But do you really measure and control work in progress as Kanban methodology states? In DevOps team, because of those cross dependencies and level of centralization, we will have lots of tasks in status like on hold, in some ways of on hold. For example, ready for testing, ready for acceptance, waiting for input, blocked, on hold due to priorities, waiting for some other task to be completed. You know, from Kanban point of view, all of those statuses are treated as in progress. And sometimes you're forgetting about this. Sometimes teams and their managers are forgetting that on hold is also in progress, and we are creating more and more in progress tasks. And so in some time, when some time passed, we are droning in this on hold. And another issue with Kanban is that DevOps team still need to improve the CI/CD pipeline and the ways of delivery. And DevOps team itself should generate ideas and improvements. DevOps team itself should also do some kind of retrospective and think about continuous improving their work, and not only incoming tasks, but also the services and the pipeline quality they are providing for the delivery. So Kanban is also in some way broad. But let's step back and take a look at Agile itself. And we may see that Agile is also not so okay for the DevOps and for the team, the which project and product is cross, creates cross dependencies with other products. So in Agile, when we are talking about DevOps team, let's have a question. Do you manage waste? Yeah. How do you do this? How do you think about creating waste in DevOps world? You know, Agile manifesto, yeah, work in code over the comprehensive documentation. When your code is being used by different teams and different stakeholders, the working codes equals comprehensive documentation as well with working code. When you are in cross-dependent environment, do you really embrace and welcome changes? Because if you change something global, if you change something, for example, on infrastructure level, it may affect all teams, and it may block or disrupt all the works in your organization. Sometimes simplicity does not work because simplicity in some meanings means that break things, move fast. And sometimes you have to create workarounds. Sometimes you have to like fix problem fast and then think about how to do this. And in this way, Agile is also a bit broken. We've been discussing the self-organized team in terms of Scrum and Kanban. So how self-organized is your Agile process right now? And what do you discuss on retrospectives? Are you playing the blame game? Are you thinking about why did you break some other works with implementing these changes? And what do you really discuss on your retrospective? Do you really discuss on how to make things better? And what are the things that actually should be better? So let's think about how to fix that, how to fix the problem when modern methodologies are not exactly intended to fix it. Let's start with basic hygiene. So, yeah, wash your hands, wear a mask, and do some stuff in your agile delivery organization in the way how you organize your work. Like, for example, you can work with Scrum in some ways. You can work in sprints, but you should dedicate story point capacity for sprints for ad hoc tasks. But still, you can work in sprints in that way. It won't be a Scrum itself, but it may add some mixture of it and sometimes fix basic problems. Treat your on hold tasks as work in progress and split them into categories like ready for acceptance and other on hold statuses. So have lots of on hold statuses, categorize them as on hold and categorize on hold as a work in progress as well, and prioritize on hold tasks first because they need to be unblocked and sometimes you just cannot finish them without this prioritizing. Just do not lose those tasks. And maintain your priorities. It's okay to review your backlog in terms of what is critical, what is not, and when the task is incoming, you may also ask about criticality and about priority of this task. And don't believe other teams and other vendors and other developers from the client side that this task is critical. Just assess it well. You can also help with designating champions on different issues or different topics. For example, you can designate a security champion who will concern about security stuff and be responsible for communication with the security and cybersecurity team from client side. It's much easier than hire a security specialist into your outsourcing team and then sell this person to the client and then put another person into the process. Just designate champion and this champion will be like owner of this part of your work. And maintain your capacity. So sometimes DevOps teams and many teams, but DevOps the most, are feeling overburdened and out of energy because of distractions, because of ad hoc tasks, because of context switches, because they have to cover lots of topics. And one thing that you can do is to provide self-service to the development team. And development team will be able to create pipelines, to create, for example, new application in the environment by themselves without affecting DevOps. Just invest a bit into education and show them how to do it, how to use, for example, your shared pipeline library. Sometimes bureaucracy can also help. It's okay to ask people to create a ticket. It's okay to ask people to create acceptance criteria in this ticket. And some level of bureaucracy, if you're not overdoing it, it also helps to fix and give you some time and space to breathe. And if we will narrow the whole agile processes to one advice, I would say it will be do retros and reflect on your effectiveness. So think about your effectiveness on every retro meeting. But let's discuss on how we can fix the system level process. To fix the system level process, we need to fix the way how we think about things. So the common problem and the common delusion of the modern software development is that result of the software development is a static product. Of course, the product is never static. Sometimes you need to change it with a newer one. Sometimes you need to add more integration. Sometimes you will have increase in performance or in number of user and you have to respond to that. Sometimes you need to just check some hypothesis against real life users. So the product in production, it's not a static thing. And the main value, the main aim and goal, and here where money lies actually, is that the main product and the main focus of software delivery is how fast you can implement changes. So if you are shifting focus from the product itself, from the package, to the value stream, to the rail, how fast the rails can bring more and more packages to the production. If you will discuss with your customer and with your team as well, that the CI/CD pipeline and the infrastructure behind your delivery is actually a main product that you deliver and all other products are based on it. And your, so the success of your project is also based on CI/CD pipeline, then you may fix issues with DevOps, because the main problem, the main issue, the main system level approach that creates this toxicity is that DevOps does not have their own product, or the product of DevOps is secondary compared to the product that brings money for your customer. So basically, CI/CD pipeline is not just a tool. It is the product the whole organization delivers. And if we think about pipeline and about CI/CD as a product, we may see that speed of changes, speed of application delivery, speed of deploying into production is dependent on CI/CD pipeline highly. And end-to-end delivery pipeline is actually a defining factor for the value stream and for the value of your software development organization. So let's think about CI/CD pipeline as the main product that defines the value for all teams and all products in the organization. And if we call CI/CD pipeline as a product, then this product should definitely have a product owner, a person who will discuss the pipeline abilities, features, requirements, functional, non-functional requirements with the business on a business language and bring it to your backlog as a DevOps team. So, a single person should own the value stream speed on a business level. And this person will be responsible for critical parameters of the CI/CD pipeline and the delivery processes. So, like for example, iteration size, because smaller iterations are easier to implement and easier to fix and easier to test, comparing to larger releases. Build deploy speed, because faster you build, faster you deploy, faster you get your feedback and may check and change something. So we are embracing changes. We are working with increasing the speed of changes. And that's why we need to shorten the feedback loop and increase the feedback quality to make sure we can implement better changes and to do less waste. Of course, we should automate everything that is possible to automate and make sure that all routine steps are made in automated way. This process should be also should maintain integrity, because if this process can be avoided, this means that sometimes developer will, I don't know, push to master. Sometimes if you are creating a different alternative process, you should do it only if this process is better. And if you are owning as a product owner the CI/CD pipeline, you should know about someone who is creating another product or another POC or another MVP CI/CD pipeline. Of course, I already told you that this pipeline should be self-service. And this pipeline also should be sustainable and fixable in terms of self-recovery logic, because we still have to manage our infrastructure. We still have to support our production and make sure that production is working correctly and reliably. So what will happen and what did happen on huge cross-dependent projects when we designate a CI/CD and the pipeline product owner, and when we designate it at least internally on outsourcing level, or sometimes we even discussed this with the customer and customer agreed with us that CI/CD is the main product that we are focusing on, and here's the product owner for the pipeline and for the end-to-end delivery. Well, actually things started to change to good, mostly. And for example, why? Because if the team has a value stream as a main focus, yeah, and there is a criteria for task prioritization, does this task affect the value stream itself? Product owner can also help in prioritizing tasks and filtering out those tasks that shouldn't be done. Also, a product owner can clarify the task and get more information about acceptance criteria for the CI/CD tasks. team may work back to Scrum without breaking it, without having those issues I described when I was saying about broken Scrum, because team becomes independent. It has its own product and it has all the resources to maintain this product and to deliver its product. So team is fully independent till team can be self-organized. Team can product its own ideas and be responsible for the product on the CI/CD pipeline level. Also, we will have a central reporting source as a product owner will communicate to business. Cross dependencies will become feature requests instead of being natural disaster and being treated like something that will always happen. We just cannot do anything without it. And also, on a business level, product owner can deal with the team's resistance. For example, if you are changing the pipeline, sometimes development teams are resisting those changes because it will break their own pace of work. Because product owner will have those requests on breaking things and changing the pipeline on a business level. And there will be a stakeholder supporting this change. And from my experience, in 2-3 months, the hopeless project, which were called toxic, and I've been on few of those in 2-3 months, when we changed this paradigm shift and changed the way we treat the CI/CD pipeline, the project on the different levels, like for example, cooperation and conflicts between teams can be fixed and can become much more comfortable and easy to work in. So let's make a conclusion. First of all, shift your thinking about DevOps work and the work delivery work itself to focus on value stream. Designate a CI/CD product owner as a single person who will own the whole value stream as a product. And of course, conduct hygiene, automate things, provide self-service, maintain your capacity, maintain your tickets, maintain your ad hoc tickets and backlog, and you will fix the toxic project. Thank you for your attention. And now you will have some time to ask questions. I will gladly respond to them.